Well, we just went to a an estate, and we picked up all kinds of goodies. But the one thing that I got, which I'm going to start working on, by the way, this is another episode of Radiorama, where I show you how to work on radios, televisions, and other things that run on glowing vacuum tubes. And we have a Magnavox Stereo console, black and white TV. I don't know anything about it. I don't know its working condition. I don't know what year it was made. Just got it. Let's see. Model number. I can't read it. It's faded. 3MB. 36. I can't tell. Anyway, we'll take it home and begin working on it within the next few days, probably. All right, I'm back home. My wife helped me unload this thing, and I already took the back off. It was only held on with about 3 or 4 screws. This came from a retired television repair shop guy. So I have high hopes for it that it might actually still work or take very little to get working. Let's see. It looks like there is a more recent replacement. This electrolytic, that's probably from the 70s. This is interesting. Looks like it's an earlier PCB board. Well, PCB board chunks added to a metal chassis, rather. Let's see. We have 4 speakers. Of course, that's the television chassis. Here's the amplifier chassis. The tuner chassis. Looks like the television controls are up top side, and we have all of our V-hold, contrast, brightness all in the back here. I guess the idea, well, you can see it's listed. I guess the idea was that you, even though this is against the wall, you could just adjust it. CRT at least does not look like it has any cataracts or anything. I am rather curious if it works. I'm thinking about bringing it up very slowly on a variac, very slowly, and see if I have any life. All right, here goes nothing. Just gonna bring it up a little few increments at a time. No telling how long this thing's been out of service. It was sitting in the middle of the living room of this house. There was actually a ton of TVs in there, as you might imagine. Lots and lots and lots of Zenith and Magnavox sets. I think there were a bunch of different certificates on the wall, and he was certified for all of them. RCA, General Electric, Magnavox, Zenith, you name it, Montgomery Ward, Sears. The other thing that he had that was really interesting was a General Electric Portacolor. That was in 1966, the first portable color television that was made available. All right, we went from 20 40%. Let's see if I see at least any pilot lights up here. I'm not really seeing any action. That's a little concerning. Bring it up just a little bit more. Still don't really see anything. Let's see if even the record player turns on. Yeah, the record player is trying to turn on, so we're definitely getting power. Okay, I'm turning that off. That's the sound of bad electrolytic capacitors, that buzzing noise. So that's as far as I'm going to get with the test. We're going to have to do some basic stuff. Basically recapping everything, the tuner, amp chassis, television chassis, and so that's all I'm going to do for the day. It's Easter. I spent half the day rummaging through this house full of stuff. I even came back with this thing. I love kitschy Christmas decorations and this rather bizarre Japanese Delmonico made by JVC. All right, we'll resume this tomorrow. All right, welcome to the second official day of working on the Magnavox console, television stereo system. And as we last met on this project, it was starting to hum when I got up to about the 60% mark, and I don't want to risk damaging anything, so it needs a recap job. And televisions are a little bit more tricky because the microfarad rating is a lot higher than you see in radios. We have two values in this can. We have a 100 microfarad and 130 microfarad, and it appears to be a chassis ground cap, so that's good. That means it'll be easier to mount a terminal strip if I have the room, which I'm curious about. It looks like everything's really tight here. We have this other one over here that's on a floating ground because it's got a phenolic wafer underneath it, and then we have another one here. Something that's really important that I can't stress enough is you need to make sure before you start working on stuff like this when it comes to TVs is to discharge the CRT. It doesn't matter if it's been off for 5 minutes or 5 years. These CRTs basically act like a gigantic capacitor, and they can store a charge almost indefinitely. And the way that you discharge these guys is we kind of need to lift up this little flap here. I usually get a screwdriver or something, and you need to touch the anode that goes into that CRT to ground. Luckily, there's a ground right here. We can use that. I've pulled the, what's known here as the V501 tube. I believe that's the vertical output tube. The reason is because this particular type of tube can't really be tested accurately on a tube tester. The last two sets I've worked on, I didn't have any raster, and even though the tube tested good, the tube was actually bad in the end, so I just got a new old stock vertical output tube to put in its place. I did check out the flyback, and it looks like your typical flyback, which is that it has a little bit of crumblies underneath it. We can see there's a little bit of melted wax. That is not unusual. Apparently most of them do that. They're actually pretty durable, according to some of the people I've been talking to. So the first thing is going to be discharging that CRT and then pulling the television chassis. Looks like just two screws will pull this entire gang of pots here. We have a bolt here. We have a bolt there. We probably have some coming through the bottom. We do. I can see them. I can feel them. Not much holding it in. I kind of appreciate the fact that this will be a lot easier to work on versus some TVs where the entire chassis includes the CRT and it's difficult to get in and around things. So it's kind of a no-brainer how this is hooked up. You can't make a mistake. You've got, you know, plugs and everything where it makes sense. On these Magnavoxes, I find sometimes it's confusing as far as their speaker hookups. Luckily, they do have a little diagram here that shows you what goes where. These speakers I find on these Magnavoxes are not that great. They're just kind of meh, but whatever. All right, so let's discharge that CRT. It's hard to film, but I've peeled back the little anode here. I'm touching the chassis with my screwdriver. I'm seeing no sparks or anything, so I don't think it really had a charge to begin with, probably because the chassis is not able to provide high voltage to the flyback right now. So I can go ahead and pull that off because it is attached to the flyback, and then we'll disconnect all these cables, remove the chassis, take it over to the workbench. All right, so this is the TV chassis removed. While I was at it, I went ahead and removed the amp chassis. It's about as basic as you can get. It's interesting, that one capacitor out there looks like it's been physically damaged. I don't like the fact that this has a lot of cadmium corrosion on it. In fact, before I get started, I'm probably going to put on some gloves and use some cleaners to remove all the loose stuff before I start working. I'd rather just not touch it if I can help it. All right, that's better. Got pretty much all that powdery stuff off of there and threw away the gloves, washed my hands, so I'm ready to begin work on this. And the first thing is going to be replacing all these electrolytics. I'll start with this one. Where's that one that's sitting isolated? 130 microfarads. There's only one value in here. That's not too bad. We can use the lug. The mounting lug of the electrolytic is negative, so we can just run the lug out of the new electrolytic here. We only got one positive lead going there. That's not bad. I've got this one, which is turned around the other way, so I can't really see the values. Let's see. It says 100 microfarads can come a negative, which makes sense. And how many values do we have? There's three. Of course, that thing is just turned all the way around like that. How annoying. I can see two of the values. I can't see the third. Might have to pull it up. See if I can find a schematic for that. But we'll start with what we can get at first. So these two values first. And then this guy over here, and then we'll have to dig up a schematic to replace that. Alright, so I've replaced two of the cans, and I know it looks messy, but there was no real place to mount a terminal strip, but that's okay. What I did is I tined them all to the grounds as close as I could to the source, and the reason they're all bunched up like that is because, for example, this one is 100 microfarads and 130 microfarads. I don't have 100 microfarad individual caps, so I had to double and even triple some up. So I've got two 47 microfarads and a 22 here. That gives me 120 microfarads thereabouts. That's close enough to the 130 microfarads for that one value. And then the other one was 100 microfarads. Now I just mounted them to the terminal strips, or not the terminal strips, the lugs of the can. They're pretty solidly. Same with this guy over here, 130 microfarads. So I put two 47s and 122 together. That's close enough. The last one's going to be the most challenging. I've got four values here. I did shine a mirror underneath and was able to determine what all the values were. So here's what we have. This will be 100 microfarads rated at 350 volts. There's one 5 microfarad rated at 350 volts. There's 100 microfarads rated at 50 volts. And we got 22 rated at 350. Or 20 rated at 350. So that's our four values. I'll try to do the same thing here. This is all chassis ground, so I can be creative if I have to. All right, well, all the electrolytics are replaced, and yes, I know some of you guys are rolling your eyeballs in the back of your head because it's not exactly the neatest looking thing, but it's effective. These guys aren't going to move. They're in there pretty good. Their negatives are tied down as close as they can to the negatives on the chassis. I can replace a few more of these caps here, but I'm a little wary of these guys. There's two of these 10th of a microfarad rated caps that are at 1,000 volts, and when you come to televisions, you probably need to observe that voltage. There's a few more in here. A lot of people look at these ceramic guys, and they're not really sure what to make of them. All these are, they're just ceramic tubes that have paper caps inside, so they should not be trusted. So I'll replace these other two caps. It's almost 6 o'clock. I could probably start on this amplifier. These are simple as apple pie. It's just a singleted 6BQ5 output, which is maybe good for about 5 watts channel. And what do we have here? We have three electrolytics in this can here, this poor little smushed can. And that's it. There's no paper caps in there. This guy looks like it got hot. Kind of boiling over looking. Might need to check that guy. Not much to write home about on that guy. The tuner chassis is probably not amazing either. Luckily it's pretty clean compared to the rest of everything else because it was protected under there. I see we have two electrolytics in this can here. It's probably a few paper caps inside. Magnavox was pretty simple. They were pretty much the antithesis of over-engineering everything. And it's interesting, I actually knew people back home who worked at Magnavox. That was back when they had moved, I think, corporate offices from Indiana to Knoxville, Tennessee, and then it was bought by Thompson Electric, I believe, sometime in the 80s. And I think it was one of the last American electronics manufacturers that still made TVs, because they were making them way up until the 90s, maybe even, I think, maybe 2000, thereabouts, and they shut it all down. The name is still around, but it's just like, that's all that exists. It's like RCA. It's just a name. All right, let's go ahead and start on the amp chassis. Went ahead and pulled the tube so I don't damage them when I do this. And we're going to replace these four electrolytics. Here's the can mounted up top. It is a chassis mounted cap, so that means by default the chassis itself is negative. We have, I believe, I marked it down, we have a 20 microfarad here and then two 30s here, and then we have a 30 microfarad here at the low voltage, only like 50 volts. We can reroute its mounting somewhere over here. We've got this yellow wire here and this chassis mount here. And I don't have any 30 microfarad caps, so I'm going to use some 47 microfarads. It's fine. As long as your values are at or greater, you should be okay. A little bit of tar coming out of this guy. That's not unusual. They sometimes seep like that when they're in long-term use. Not the end of the world. Again, I don't know what's up with that. I'm going to measure its resistance just to make sure we're okay, because it looks a little cooked, but appearance means nothing sometimes, and oftentimes it's perfectly fine. All right, so again, there's not much going on with this amplifier. I replaced all four electrolytics. We got the little bitty low voltage guy, 20 microfarad, and the two 30 microfarad caps put in their rightful places. The last thing I'm going to do before I call it quits on this thing for the evening is I'm going to clean the balance control here. There's a little pot here. Put a little juice in it. Don't be afraid to use a lot of it. Just work that in. All right, so that chassis is done. TV chassis, I need to get the high voltage caps. I'll need to take the tuner out, and obviously I also need to take the record player out. It tried to turn, but I can tell it's gunked up a little bit. The bearing seems okay, but probably we've got some issues with the changer mechanism. I'm trying to remember who made these. I think they might be... I don't remember. I'll have to take it out of there. I think it's British, but these were called Micromatix. That was Magnavox's brand of a LP player from about this time period. Blah, whatever. It's Thursday. We're off tomorrow. So I've already been imbibing with my beer, but I think we got a good start. So tomorrow we will resume with the electronic restoration. This is going a lot smoother than I thought, which means something catastrophic is going to happen for sure. But we can at least do the assessments once we do the full recap tomorrow and maybe bring it up slowly on a variac and see if we have any life out of the CRT, the stereo, the radio, all that good stuff. All right, well, I came over to the museum and I got my two capacitors I needed. Meanwhile, check this out. I know this won't mean much to most people, but this is something that came in with the same estate that the stereo that we're working on came from. It is a General Electric Portacolor TV. These were significant when they came out. They were actually the first portable color TV available in the U.S. And I'm not going to describe technically why it's important. RCA had this interesting mask that they had developed for separating the three, RGB colors. And it wasn't that efficient, and it was pretty complicated as far as the guns and how they were arranged. And it took a lot of beam power to get through the mask. And General Electric, they arranged the guns side by side versus in a triangular configuration, and they slightly rounded the mask holes, which is just a metal mesh. And it was more stable, it was cheaper to manufacture, didn't require as much beam power to get past the mask. And they made this TV from 1966 all the way up to 1978. And it was the last TV sold in the U.S. that still had vacuum tubes in it. So it's pretty amazing to think that, you know, I was actually alive when this damn thing was made and they were still using vacuum tubes. We're going to keep it for the museum because it's significant. Eventually, I'm going to try to clean the pots and stuff. It seems like I'm not able to get a signal through it very well. But it seems like the got a really strong raster. Yeah, you can kind of, I'm not sure if this shows up, you can see that metal mesh slash mask there for, it's called a divergence mask, I believe. So I've got my goodies. I'm going to stick around a little bit. The museum president's coming by. We got a bunch of junk we need to haul off. Here's another one. And of course, the picture's not really going to film properly. But look at this thing. This is like a 70s era Zenith. Damn it, it's too bad you can't really videotape television screens, but the picture on this is phenomenally good. I don't know. I guess I get excited about nerdy shit like this. Very cool. All right, I am back from the museum, and I have the parts that I need to replace the rest of these paper caps here. There are a total of 4 that need to be replaced. While I was at it, I took the tuner chassis out, and kind of like the amplifier, there's not much going on here. There's 2 electrolytic capacitors, and it looks like we have 2, possibly 3 paper caps. I'm not sure what that black thing is. Looks like a black beauty. In fact, it looks like we have 2 of those here. No, they're miniature electrolytics. Low voltage electrolytics. Those are probably fine. Obviously, we need to clean all the pots here. I want to check to make sure that all the zillions of pilot lamps are still good. Because that would stink to put it all back in there. I want to find out the pilot lights are burned out and not easy to get at. We have 3. We have 1 for the station indicator and 1 for either end that illuminates the dial scale, and I think we have 1 in the turret tuner here. It's this guy here. It illuminates the numbers. Definitely want to make sure that's good, because if not, if that's out, you won't be able to tell what channel you're on. But let's go ahead and replace the rest of the capacitors, and I think then it'll be time to take the record player out and see what's going on with it. And before I put everything back in the cabinet, I think since everything will be out, it'll be easier just to go ahead and clean up the cabinet, get it all ready for reassembly and testing. I'm not sure if it'll work. Televisions are a hell of a lot more complicated than radios, and I have no idea of knowing if that CRT is good or not, because I don't have a CRT tester. It's luck of the draw. We figured even if the CRT is bad, oops, it's got enough desirability just because of the styling. People seem to love these stupid peg legs these days, so it's got a lot going for it. I suspect the CRT is okay. There's no brightener on it, and it came out of a television repairman's house, and every TV we've gotten out of this guy's house have really good CRTs. So I've got a lot of hope on this, but I could eat my own words, so we'll see. All right, so we got this chassis, the tuner chassis, overhauled. 2 new electrolytic capacitors here. Paper caps are replaced here with these new yellow guys. And now I'm going to clean all the pots. And you just do it by squirting juice into the openings. All of them. Don't be afraid to use a lot, because if you don't do it right the first time and you have to take it all apart again, you're going to be sorry. Just work it in there real good. Don't be afraid to do it again, just to make sure and flush it real good. It's feeling a lot better. Then we need to do the wafer switches for all the different selections. Man, I'm having a hard time turning this one. Might need to put a knob on that later. I want to lubricate all of the bearings in the tuning condenser. I'm using a product called TriFlow. Works great. It's usually used for bicycles, but I find it works great for just about anything else that needs to turn easily. That's already starting to turn better. We'll lubricate all of the pulleys that are up here as well. Looks like we got a switch. No wonder that was so hard to turn. This thing turns that as well. Let's go ahead and clean the switch as well. Put the wrong shit in there. No biggie. There we go. That's turning a lot better. Then we'll turn it over. That'll drain excess cleaner out of there. And again, we want to touch up some of these pulleys with just a little skosh. So I want to touch some of these other guys. I want to check all these pilot lights to make sure they're good. And clean the glass here. I might take the glass out and clean it from the inside as well, depending on how dirty it is. All right, so I yanked the turntable out of there. And the way that you pull these guys is they always have these little clips here. They fold over like that when they're inside the cabinet. Fold them over like that, and then you pull it straight up. It is a British unit. First of all, it looks like the rubber shock mounts for the motor are in great shape. That's outstanding. It seems like that everything's real loose, loosey-goosey. That's unusual. Maybe it's been serviced at least once. This guy was, as I mentioned, a service guy. I do want to see what kind of condition the rubber friction wheel is. We have a bunch of these players sitting at the museum somewhere. So, see if I can pull this off. Let me put this down for just a second. Let's see if I can pull this. This doesn't make for very good video. Let me pull this off and then I'll show you what it looks like underneath. Alright, so I pulled that off. Ooh, these guys are good and squishy. Rubber's in great shape. The grease isn't really that solidified. Overall in great shape. I think I'm going to take both these off and clean them up. I'm going to get some oil to re-lubricate the motor, even though it seems like it's turning quite nicely. Let's see what the situation is with the cartridge and needle. That looks good. I have tons of extra needles in case we need one, but I'm not sure if we do. But what I'm going to do is after I take these rubber friction wheels off, I'm going to take it out side and set it in my nasty pan of nastiness and squirt the crap out of this with the solvent to remove all the old grease, and then squirt it down with WD-40 to clean the rest of it out, and then use this TriFlow stuff. And I'm going to take these bearings out, clean those out, and then after that we'll give this a good cleaning. The one thing I want to do before I call the electronics done is I am going to run a line in through the tape input so that someone can run their audio through it, whether it be a Bluetooth or whatever. I will say this, all the pilot lights in this thing were bad, were gone. Well, basically they were open. So this thing may have had quite a heavy amount of usage. It's also interesting because about 50% of the tubes have been replaced with different brands. So it could have been a fairly heavily driven machine. Again, I have no idea if all of this work is going to amount to anything, if it's going to work, but that's part of the excitement of working on these things. You just never know. All right, now that I have this thing sitting in the pan of disgustingness, I'm going to clean all the grease and shit out of there. And once you get some in there, work it back and forth a bunch. Go. It's already turning a lot better. Let's see if I can get some way down in there. Well, that can's just about empty. Brake cleaner's great stuff. There we go. All right, that evaporates real quick. Now it's time to soak everything in WD-40. I know a lot of record player guys are probably looking at this and rolling their eyeballs. It's like, then that's the wrong way to do it. And you know what? It probably is. I'm not a record player guy. All right. Just get everything. Just make sure, try to avoid getting it too much on the electronics. Everything is already moving a lot smoother, including this eccentric area. There we go. Yep, everything is loosening up nicely. I'll let that sit there and evaporate and drain out for a little while. I think I'm going to go actually feed my roses. My wife hates the roses, but I've been trying to keep them alive for years. Stupid hobby. Oh well. All right, well, I've brought it back in. What I also did is I took the idler wheels over to the sink and I cleaned the crap out of them. And then you want to roughen up the edges with a little bit of fine sandpaper. I also clean all the contact points with rubbing alcohol to make sure there's nothing that's going to possibly slip. It seems like everything is moving really smoothly. I hope that bodes well as far as actual operation when I put it back in the cabinet. So I'll put the platter back on, and then it'll be time to go over and do some cabinetry cleanup. And then we will start the process of reassembly, and then we'll do some testing to see if all that work did anything at all. All right, now it's time to start cleaning up the cabinet a little bit. I think the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take a damp rag. Let's get all the dirt off first before I start going at it with various furniture cleaning products that you've probably seen me use on this show a lot. There's a lot of Formica used on this, like this top here. It's either a decal or it's Formica. So basically it's a type of plastic. So using furniture polish on that is kind of a stupid idea. The rest of this is indeed wood. And so let's clean it up. I think the guy must have been a smoker. There's a lot of nicotine stains that are coming off as I do this. You know, everyone smoked back then, so it's not unusual. Yeah, you can see all the yellow stains here. So I'll go over this with just a damp rag. This is also plastic or a decal. Not real wood, but whatever, it's fine. All right, so now that the cabinet's been kind of cleaned up, I'm gonna use my favorite product called Old English. Of course, a helicopter's going overhead right now. And I was looking at this a little more closely. That is a photocell, so this must have at some point had a remote. Of course, the remote's long gone, but still, it's kind of neat. So I'm gonna use this Old English to go over the woodwork. I'm not gonna go over the plastic stuff. That'd make no sense. It won't do any good. And that'll kind of even it up and get rid of some of the discolorations and the scratches. And then this stuff here I'll probably go over with car wax because that'll polish it up. It should have come with a fine sheen when it was from the factory. People liked shiny things back then. And maybe I'll go over the woodwork, depending on how shiny it is, with the wax as well to seal it up, bring back the gloss. And then it'll be time to be putting everything back in. By the way, I've got the bearings on this oiled so well, it'll spin there for a full minute. So I've got high hopes for that working just fine. Whew! All right. It's taking a bit of elbow grease, but this is closer to what it should have looked like from the factory, which is kind of a gloss. I've only gone over it with one pass of the wax. Probably go over it with several more just to really even it out, because it's a little splotchy here. It's looking pretty good there. Yeah, I know this sounds crazy, but nicotine seems to do a great job of preserving surfaces, metal and wood, and that seems to be the case here. After stripping all the nicotine tar and stuff off, there's a nice, clean, shiny surface underneath all that. So probably one or two more passes with the wax. And what I'm using, by the way, is Carnauba paste wax. Looks like this. Kind of smells like bananas, which is kind of nice. And this one's too delicate to use the hand buffer, so I'm using old socks to apply the wax. And then using an old t-shirt to buff it off. Whew! Well, I got my workout for the day. Anyway, this guy's all shined up and ready to put back together again. So I think I'm going to face it towards the sun so I can see more of the innards. It's time to reassemble and see if this works. I've got a bad feeling. I feel like I've had too much luck on this, and usually that means something catastrophic is going to happen. I don't like to jinx myself. There's a shit ton of hardware to hold this back together, so I hope that I remember where all these go. Whew! Well, I got my workout for the day. Anyway, this guy's all shined up and ready to put back together again. So I think I'm going to face it towards the sun so I can see more of the innards. It's time to reassemble and see if this works. I've got a bad feeling. I feel like I've had too much luck on this, and usually that means something catastrophic is going to happen. I don't like to jinx myself. There's a shit ton of hardware to hold this back together, so I hope that I remember where all these go. All right, folks, well, it is time for the truth. I'm going to go ahead and turn it on, at least on the stereo portion. And I'm going to bring it up slowly on the variac here. Bring it up about 50%. See if we have any pilot lights glowing away. I don't really see any. That's not the most promising sign, for sure. Yeah, I'm not seeing anything here. That's odd. Wonder if this guy tripped. All right, let's try this again. Nobody's home. Nobody's home at all. Beginning to wonder if I plugged up, connected the things together correctly. Let me try something. I noticed there's an outlet on the TV chassis, and it looks like the power is coming into the chassis. And I have the TV hooked up to the amp. I mean the tuner, that's probably not right. That's a stupid mistake on my part. All right, let's try this again. All right, I'm seeing pilot lights now, so that's a good sign. Let's see if I start seeing glowing in the amplifier section. Yes, I am. I just realized something. I'm running the TV without the vertical output tube, so I need to put that in there. Okay, after a couple of false starts, including forgetting to connect the anode back to the TV, we do have raster here. It's not super bright, then again, I'm out in the bright garage. I think I need to Should have cleaned the turrets on the other turret controls, or the turret contacts on the thingy up here. It seems like it's a little bit dirty. I don't have a signal to inject. I meant to bring that out here, but I forgot. But in the meantime, we can test the other features. Like, this is weird. Is the TV supposed to stay on? Maybe, I don't know. Try this phonograph over here. Well, it's interesting, it turns the TV off when you go to phono. Da-da-da-da-da, on. Whoa! Must be on 78 or something. It is. Alright. See if I have any sound. Oh, we do have sound. That's good. Should have brought a record over here so I could test it. Let me get a record. That seems to work pretty well. Pretty pleased about that. Usually record players are not my thing. No, the TV stays on. I wish I could find the owner's manual for that. That just seems like a bizarre thing to leave your fucking TV on while the stereo is playing. I don't know, maybe they figured you'd watch TV more on it than you'd be listening to your records. It seems like a waste of the CRT to leave it on like that all the time. But we seem to be firing on all cylinders. All right, well, last thing I'm going to do is test the Bluetooth input feature. Let's see, does that turn off the whole unit? Yeah, that turns off the whole unit. I'm assuming what happens is when it gets to the end of the record, it shuts itself off. Then shuts the whole unit off. That was typical back then. So let me get the Bluetooth thingy and we'll try that out. And then I think it's time to button this thing up. Welcome to the unanticipated day number 3 of working on the Magnavox television stereo system. And two things. First of all, I thought that the TV itself did not shut off at all when you were, for example, using either the AM/FM stereo or the record player. Turns out I should have looked a little more closely because there are two outlets on the back of the tuner chassis, and I can't film it because I can't get underneath there, but what it boils down to is there's a label that I didn't see. It says marked TV power, and that is a switched outlet. So when you switch from TV to any of these other selections, it turns the TV off, which is what I want. Second of all, I actually filmed what I thought was the last part of the episode yesterday. Everything was working fine, or so I thought, and then all of a sudden this relay flipped and the TV went dead. I was like, oh God, what's going on here? And I remember I'd seen some earlier style solid state diodes as the rectifier, and one of them was super hot, and I figured those things are probably not as stable as modern diodes, so I replaced both of them and that restored power. Now the last thing I'm going to do today, because I do feel like the CRT is a little bit dim, is I'm going to take it over to the museum, and we have a CRT rejuvenator. Sorry, it's early in the morning. And what those do is you can cook your CRT a little bit and bring back some of its brightness. I've only done it one other time, so I'm gonna have to have someone guide me through how to do it, or at least read the instructions on the tester. But I'm gonna button this up and try to load it in the back of my truck by myself. Unfortunately, my wife went away on a day trip early this morning, so she can't help me. And I really don't want to break these peg legs off. That would be unfortunate. So I'm gonna put it on cardboard and slide it over to the truck and then slide it in. Of course, a rational person would get one of his buddies to come help, and I'm not that kind of person. So anyway, we're mostly done here. I'm hoping by the end of the day I'll have enhanced the CRT a little bit. Maybe I'll put a little more polish on it, and then we'll do a final test. Make sure it's up and running, leave it running for a little while, and that'll be it. That'll be at the end of this harrowing episode. All right, so I know that this will not show up in video because modern digital cameras do not record CRT TVs very well, because you see that white band going up and down the set. I need to make a few final adjustments in the back. I'm going to use an old TV repairman's trick, which is put a mirror in front of it, and that way when I'm back here making these adjustments, there's a focus, width, and vertical height adjustments are all in these. Unfortunately, I need to get a flashlight. I can barely see what I'm doing back here. But I'll adjust these, and that will be the final as far as getting this fine-tuned up and ready to go. Probably want to let it run for a little while today just to make sure there's going to be no other issues, but I think we're not doing too bad here. So I'll shut up and do these adjustments, and then we'll probably call it a day and wrap this episode up. All right, so we are now firing on all cylinders. Everything seems to be working pretty well. I remember when I was a kid, our TVs all had shitty little speakers in it.
Outstanding attitude, Denise. When you got a major paper, but you blow it off, you come here and you answer
Anyway,
the phone.
that sounds pretty good. The TV is working well. Let's go over to the auxiliary input. Now let's go to record player. Get that arm loose. Put it down to phono selection. Power up. On. And what speed are we on? 33. That's working good. Let's try FM radio.
Free MPG with Toyota's industry-leading.
Funny, this is the song that my brother was named after, Jesse's Girl. Anyway, it seems to be working quite well. I'm gonna let it play here for a little while just to make sure that nothing's gonna pop from heat or anything, and we'll call it an episode. Anyway, thanks so much for watching and sticking with me on this long and arduous project. I kind of enjoyed working on it. It was a lot of fun, and I think it'll make someone very happy in the probably a very near future. All right, as always, thanks for watching. If you have any questions or comments, you can leave them down in the comments section below. And until the next time that something comes across the workbench, I'll see you guys next time. Adios.